We don't have a very good idea of what we mean culturally or as a world when we talk about science. Science, to be understood, has to be broken into two component parts. One of them is the story, the other is the technique. My name is Liam Schaff. I'm author of Official Stories, currently working on my new book, American Heretic. I'm going to be doing a short series on what is science. This is part one. Understanding science requires that we first separate it from religion. So let's look at religion. Religion is a series of stories. Many people accept these as mythical or exaggerated. Some people think they're literally true. They have a very hard time demonstrating it to anybody using any kind of logic. So they, well, collect a lot of money and sometimes make themselves look foolish. Nevertheless, they think that they're right. Science thinks that it's different from religion because it knows that it doesn't just tell stories. And in a way that's true and in a way it's not. Here's the problem. Science, just like religion, is totally dependent on old stories to do the second part. The stories in science are very similar to the stories in religion. First there was nothing, there was silence on the face of the deep. First there was nothing, which exploded. If you're not in our tribe, you're ungodly and any sex you have should be an abomination. If you're a man who lies with a man, any sex you have should be an abomination. And we say HIV causes AIDS and it favors Africans and gay men. It's not really very different. We say that when you come into the tribe, you have to be blessed by the priest, you have to be cut or bled or something, purified in some way. That's the old world, that's the old world religion. And the new world religion is when you come into the world, you have to be injected with something to protect you as you enter the world. It's a kind of, well, secular scientific baptism. So we have three stories here that very much parallel, are parallel in science and in religion. Now science goes a step further. And the people who are very scientific say, well, of course, that's not true. You know, sure, there's some similarities there. We can't deny that. But there are scientific reasons why we think this. Well, are there? The difference between science and religion is that religion doesn't have a technique. Religion isn't a tool-making enterprise. Sure, there are manufactured artifacts all over Europe that, you know, there are 3,000 pieces or whatever of the original cross, equaling many, 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 many tons of wood, shipfuls of wood. Sure, there are saints' bones everywhere, and sure, there are a million places where something magical supposedly happened. And these were invented throughout the Middle Ages as kind of Disneyland theme parks for the religious-minded people at that point. I mean, religion used to, you know, our science is to religion of the past. It was the going thing that we believed in. Now we believe in science, and we're a slightly harder sell. We need a better technique to convince us. The techniques of science are, well, impressive. We are a storytelling mammal, but we're a tool-making mammal. And this is how science works. Science takes its storytelling capacity and then couples it with some very impressive tool-making. Let's go to the first example. First, there was nothing which exploded. This is not a scientific idea. You can't prove it. It sounds very much like a misunderstanding of, you know, every creation myth around the world, but without any poetry. This is what astronomy has unfortunately devolved into, and in order to prove it, well, they have used many very, very interesting, very impressive techniques. We have telescopes that can look in every range of light. We can see in every range of electromagnetic light out into outer space, and it's fascinating. We can see very, very far, well, to us very, very far, what's a tiny, tiny piece of the whole universe as far as we can tell, and the pictures are astounding. But the pictures don't get to speak for themselves. The pictures, the technique, has to conform to the story. The technique is very impressive. The story is not. So, looking out into outer space, we see, well, we know it's electrified matter. We know it's clearly plasma. We know that everything out in outer space is electromagnetic. But we don't want to say that because that robs the value of the first there was nothing which exploded story because there was nothing there about it being electric and infinite. The universe that we see, the technique, is electric and infinite. The universe that we see through our science is based on the story. First there was nothing which exploded. And you can see that there's a real hold up there. Science serves its story. Its technique may be damned impressive. Take vaccination. In the old world, we had to baptize and circumcise. Well, we didn't have to, but we did. We wanted to bless people coming into the world. It's a big, dangerous world. We wanted to give them a benediction, good words. So now we don't want to do that because, you know, we don't believe in superstitions anymore, except that we want to inject them, and here's the technique, inject them with something that we say protects them. The technique then is not as impressive maybe as that of astronomy with its telescopes. The technique is to take substrates, that's bits of animal, kidney, ovary, let's see, testicle, and grow bits of material in them that we say we got from another researcher who gave us some bit of disease, something or other. Then we mixed it together and siphoned off the liquid, spun it this way or that way, and then added some metals to it. Well, there are techniques all along this way that are, you know, kind of impressive. The ability to make finely honed glass and slides and petri dishes and incubators, laboratories, substrates themselves, the finely machined needles, and the metals that we can deposit in semi-liquid form, you know, in very, very small form into these remaining liquids from this thing. And then we put that and seal it and ship it to Walgreens where some idiot injects it into you. That's our technique. That's our technique. Not knocking all the people at Walgreens. Sorry, but if you understand what I'm saying, the technique itself should raise suspicions as to the story. The story itself should raise suspicions as to the belief in a need for a technique to bolster it. Our science is not, I think you're coming to see, true. Our science is a combination of a story. The story doesn't have to be purely religious. You could say that the story is better than that. You could say there's real research going on in the story. For example, computer science. Computer science is not beholden to any Judeo-Christian, Muslim, Hindu, any kind of story at all. It simply exists for the purpose of increasing the data speed, the speed of data transfer along binary code along, well, whatever kind of circuit we're making. So that's really it. How fast can we distribute data and have it analyzed in a subset of, you know, nested hierarchy of chips? How fast can we do that? There's your story. That's why computer science is so far in advance of our biological science, because computer science doesn't have to bow to a previously existing story. There weren't significant forms of computer, abacus, you know, adding on a brick, or, you know, inscribing cuneiform in clay. But there was no significant computer in the old world, and there's no prohibition in the Torah, the Old Testament, against computers. So computers are able to race ahead. Very interesting what happens when you're not bound to a very strange story. The HIV story. The idea that everybody who's not in our tribe is not sanctioned by God, Yahweh, Elohim, whatever, Allah, you know, Krishna, Shiva, whatever you want to believe in. If it's not sanctioned by your tribe, you think that it's not okay. And this is a way of keeping tribal identity, but we misunderstand it as religion. We then say that if you're not in our tribe, you have to get out, or you will kill you, or you can't mate with our people. Well, that's undemocratic. It's certainly not progressive, so we don't say that anymore. What we say is, if you're not in our tribe, you should definitely take one of these tests. Now, let's look at the technique of HIV testing. The technique is that a guy who committed many kinds of fraud over many, many years, named Robert Gallo, mixed together samples from 10 guys with unknown conditions, unknown levels of, but probably high levels of drug use, with some cells that were from animal and monkey and cancer cell lines and something from France that had been sped up with all kinds of other chemicals to produce a certain kind of enzyme. And then he decided that the disease that was going on in gay men who were using a ton of drugs, using carcinogenic drugs through their noses and in their anuses and colons, truly deadly carcinogens, that the disease they had to do with one incident of sex, not many, not the drugs that went along with treating STDs, just one incident of sex was enough. He decided this. And he decided that the test made of all of those sort of that witch's brew of components that I'm describing, that test would then be the gateway to the story. And if you tricked the test, if you made the test pop, then the story was true for you. Unless, of course, you weren't in those two groups. And it was very important that you be in a group, either gay men who were having sex with a lot of men using a lot of drugs, hemophiliacs, that was expanded to include hemophiliacs, IV drug users, and then all Africans. So these groups were the risk groups for which this test, which was a test to see really if the story was true, but that was the technique. Now a secondary technique was the drugs, and the drugs were intensely toxic black box labeled drugs. The FDA said they'd killed people at normal doses, and those were just dropped into the various communities that were supposedly affected by, well, the test, really. Because if we hadn't tested them with that test that wasn't specific, we might not have drugged them with those drugs that were incredibly deadly, and maybe we'd have found it another way. But that wouldn't have conformed to the story that people not in your tribe are ungodly and there's something wrong with them. So science lives inside of two areas. There's the story and there's the technique. And the story doesn't have to be any good at all for the technique to be achieved and put into motion internationally. And, you know, you can figure out how much good or damage it does based on the quality of the thinking in the story. My name is Liam Schaff. My book's Official Story is currently working on my new one. You can support this message of independent science journalism by putting a couple dollars into the PayPal link below to the side. You can get my book on Kindle and in paperback. Thanks very much. See you next time.